Hello everybody, my name is Sandra Lopez, gardener here at the Scott Arboretum. And today I'm gonna talk about some of our late summer blooming plants, especially crepe myrtles. So right behind me, I have Lagerstromia Sue. So this is a hybrid between Lagerstromia indica and Fourii. So back in the 1950s, the National Arboretum started a breeding program where the two crepe myrtle species were hybridized, and out of that they got a lot of different hybrids. So Sue is one of them. This one has pink flowers and it has a little bit of white in it. But what I want to show you also is the bark. So this is a very young plant. It's we are growing it as multi-stem. It doesn't have that nice bark, exfoliating bark yet, because it's not mature enough. But as you can see back here, some of the stems started to have some of that nice bark, exfoliating bark. A lot of the hybrids that came out of that program, breeding program, have very clean leaves. So as you can see, the leaves are dark green and are doing very well. We have been having a drought for days now, and crepe myrtles are just spectacular. They love the heat, so they are a perfect plant for this time of the year. Right behind me, I have Hydrangea paniculata phantom. This is one that Rowan covered a few weeks ago when he did his tour, so it wasn't completely open, but just look at those huge, beautiful flowers. They are huge. The phantom has one of the biggest flowers from the paniculatus. Once they mature a little bit more and get bigger, they start flopping a little bit more, but even with their floppiness, they are beautiful and spectacular in the garden. So phantom is a must-have, but it does need some room in the garden. Right here, I have butterfly milkweed, Asclepias tuberosa. It's not at its peak right now, but I'm highlighting because a few days ago, July 21st, the monarch butterfly moved into the endangered list. Here at the Scott Arboretum, we love and care about the monarchs, and we do provide habitat and food source for the monarch. As many of you might know, the Asclepias species are the only host plant for the caterpillar. So it is critical for the monarch survival. Asclepias tuberosa, it's beautiful. It's very easy to grow. You can grow it from seed. It doesn't transplant very well, but you can see here, it started to develop some seed pods. So once these mature, they will open and spread seed. A lot of times they'd seed around in the garden if you allow them to, which I would recommend. If you grow Asclepias tuberosa, let it seed. That way you have more food source for the caterpillars. I was looking for caterpillars and I didn't find any, but I did find some other insects. It's the milkweed beetle. And as you can see here on this pod, they are just eating off of the seed pod. And there are different stages of that beetle in several plants. So that's an early stage, one of the instars. But if you look at on this right here, this is the adult form of the milkweed beetle. There are other milkweed species that you can grow. Asclepias syriaca and Asclepias incarnata, and if you can grow them all, that's great. Here we have Lily Casablanca. Lilies are one of my favorite plants in the world. I name my daughter after them. This is Casablanca. This is fragrant, and typically the flowers are bigger and the plants are taller, but regardless, it's looking good and it's been blooming for days. So these are all the spent flowers that we had. Lilies are excellent plants as cut flowers, great for arrangements, and even just to have growing in the garden to provide that fragrance. This is Angelica gigas. It's very architectural plant. It also has bold foliage. So for us, this is a biennial. So it grows leaves the first year, and then the second year, since the flowering stalk and it actually starts blooming on the second year. I've heard that you can treat it as a short-lived perennial. I haven't experimented with that because I love the flowers, and even after they are finished blooming, they are beautiful. And if you get closer, so the upper leaves have like a protective sheath, which is also attractive. It's kind of purplish green, and as the plant matures, it kind of like shows the leaf. But what I like the most about this plant is the purple stems and then the flower. So these are in the carrot family, so have that umbel shaped like flower. It does attract a lot of pollinators. I'm not finding any, and it's probably because it's already, it's been pollinated, it's been spent. But here you can see how the flower also has that protective sheath. So then it will open up and a lot of the pollinators will visit it. This is Polyothyrsus sinensis, the Chinese pearl bloom. So it starts flowering mid-June until now. The flowers start white and then turn a buttery yellow, and the flowers persist for about a month. It can get between 30 and 40 feet tall, so it needs room to grow. Right now, it's towards the end of its flowering period. Earlier this year, there were a lot of honeybees, so a lot of the flowers have been pollinated. So if I shake it, it's gonna drop. All the flowers that have been pollinated. But even so, it's still looking spectacular, and the leaves also look very nice. They're dark green, clean, a little bit glossy. So even after it's flowering, it's a great plant to have in the garden. So looking at the flowers closely, if you can see the whitish buds, so those are the flower buds that haven't opened, and so they do look like pearl blooms. So that's where this tree gets its name, pearl blooms, because the buds look like white pearls. So they start white, and then as they mature and they get pollinated, they turn more of that buttery yellow in color, and then they just drop to the ground. Here again, we have Asclepias tuberosa butterfly milkweed, and I just wanted to show you that this is a great plant, low maintenance, very, very drought tolerant. We haven't had rain, real rain for days, so we are in a drought period. But just look at the ground, how dry it is. And this plant is like a workhorse. It's doing its thing, looking spectacular. So very low maintenance, good to have for that, but specifically for the monarchs. This is Lilium Black Beauty. This is an orient pet lily. So it's a hybrid between an oriental and a trumpet lily. This is a hybrid between Lilium henryi and Lilium speciosum. This one can grow between 4 and 7 feet tall. It's looking a little bit small right here. It might be because of the drought, I'm not sure. But the flowers are beautiful. They're more of like a raspberry red color. They're looking down. And a lot of times you get between 20 and 50 flowers per stem. So that's amazing. Like I said, lilies add interest to the garden, and this one is very showy and good to have in the garden. Here I have Phlox Gina. This is a butterfly magnet. Mount Cuba Center did research on phlox a few years ago, and this was one of the best or the best performer in terms of horticultural value and ecological value. It tends to grow between 4, 5, 6 feet tall. Right now it's around 6 feet tall. It's a great plant for butterflies, and I also read that it's good for hummingbirds because it does have those tubular flowers. I've never seen hummingbirds on phlox, Gina, but I've seen a lot of eastern tiger swallowtails on Gina specifically. So this is a great plant for butterflies, especially the eastern tiger swallowtail. This is Lilium silver Shahrazad. This is another of those orient pets lilies, which combines the features of the oriental and trumpet lilies. This is the moonlit version of our own Shahrazad. This one also has fragrant flowers, and it can get between 4 and 6 feet tall. The flowers are white with a little bit of a cream color in them, a little bit yellowish. For the most part, the stems can support the plants. Some need a little bit of support, but they are still beautiful and add interest, especially in the summer months when there's not much going on in the garden. This is Lagerstromia farii townhouse. It's finished blooming, but I want to show it to you because of the bark and because a lot of the other crepe myrtles that we will be seeing will have some features of farii. So farii, it's very cold hardy, zone 6. So it is the workhorse for the cold hardiness. And not to mention the bark. The bark is just amazing. This is one of my favorite crepe myrtles because of such a spectacular bark color. Right now it's kind of exfoliating. So soon it will show more of that cinnamon colored bark. This one has a base shaped, so you can appreciate the color of the trunk a little bit better, more than with the other crepe myrtles. Here we have Lobelia cardinalis, or cardinal flower. It's been blooming for a few days now, but I just want to show you because I love the rich red color on these, and these are great for attracting hummingbirds. So this is a great plant for hummingbirds. They do really well in sun as long as they have wet feet. Here in the glade garden, they do really well because the ground stays moist for the most part. Right now we are watering the garden because we are in that drought period, and that's why you see water droplets on the leaves. But this is an amazing plant to have. A lot of times when you are mulching, it's recommended that you don't mulch the crown because they don't like that. So, and they will also seed if in bare areas. So just keep that in mind when growing Lobelia. Don't mulch the crown, and don't mulch the entire space so you have different Lobelia seedlings coming in your garden, because when you grow it in masses, it really shows in the garden. Here we have Lagerstromia lipan. So this is another of those hybrids that came out of that breeding program at the National Arboretum. This one, it's smaller in size, so it gets between 15 20 feet tall, I would say more in the 15 feet tall range. This one, it's a mature plant, so the bark is not as exciting, as exfoliating as some of the mature plants. As you can see here, this one has more of a like a creamy white color, and it's really smooth. This tree, it's only about 9, maybe 10 years old, so it doesn't have a lot of the exfoliating bark yet. Most of the stems don't have exfoliating bark, but you can see on this one, it has that creamy white color and it's really smooth to the touch. A lot of the crepe myrtles we grow as multi-stem, and again, to show that nice bark. But if you wanted, you can train it as a single trunk, but I would recommend doing a multi-stem. Again, with those hybrids that came out, they are powdery mildew resistant, so the leaves are very clean. With the flowers, they bloom for a very long time, up to 100 days. So, and again, in the heat, they are just spectacular. They perform really well. And looking at these, you have flowers on some of the stems, but these have flower buds. So we are gonna get a lot more days with flowering. If you look closer at the flowers, I can see a lot of pollinating insects, smaller pollinating insects, as well as bumblebees and honeybees. So this is an excellent plant for its blooming qualities, blooming color, powdery mildew resistant, exfoliating bark, small, so perfect for small gardens. And then if you look closer, so this is one year's growth. And then here, these are last year's flowers, and you can see the seed capsules. They are also really showy. So this is another feature that this plant has. So it's a multi-season interest, year-round. There's always something to look at. This is Bitex Agnes Castus Shoal Creek. This is a PHS gold medal plant. So this is an outstanding plant to have in the garden. It's not at peak blooming right now, but when it is, it's just covered with pollinating insects. This is a great alternative for Buttlia, the butterfly bush. This is not invasive, but it has that same similar flower spike shape. A lot of the flowers are spent, and you can see that they have been pollinated because of the green seeds that you see in there. Earlier this morning, I was looking at this plant and I saw a lot of bumblebees kind of like sleeping on the spent flowers. So it's great for a food source, but also habitat for bumblebees and other insects. This one is a little bit smaller than this species, so a little bit smaller. These we treat as cutbacks. So we cut them back to about 3 feet every year. And that's probably also keeping them a little bit smaller. So here we have Bitex Agnes Castus Delta Blues. So this is one that was bred and selected by Michael Durr's son, Matthew, at the University of Georgia. This one, it's smaller than the stray species. And this one only gets to be 8 by 8 feet tall. So it's smaller, more rounded in shape. And the flowers are a more rich blue, and the flowers are closer together to the flower spike, but equally interesting and showy and spectacular as Shoal Creek. Here we have Lagerstromia Dynamite. So just look at the spectacular red flowers, also red flower buds. This one is not one of those hybrids, but this has amazing flower color and will also bloom for a long time. This plant is it's red 6 months out of the year. When it first emerges, the leaves are reddish purple, and then you have the flowers, and then it gets really nice red full color. So this is another great crepe myrtle, not one of the hybrids, but also very good with a mildew resistance. The leaves are very clean. This one, the bark It's not as showy as the Fari Eyes or any of the others, but it's it has some bark interest. Again, this is not mature enough to show that exfoliating bark, but with time, I'm hoping to see more of that exfoliating beautiful bark on this tree. Here we have Lagerstroemia Natchez. So this is one of those hybrids at the National Arboretum. It was one of the first ones that it was developed, and this one looks very much like one of its parents, Lagerstroemia Farii. If you look at the bark, it has that similar cinnamon bark color in it, so it's very attractive. This one, just like a lot of the other crepe myrtles, it's still young, so some of the branches, stems are not showing that intense exfoliating bark color. But it's still amazing to look at right now. This one, just like its parent, so it has the same bark color, but also the same base shaped. And also has the same flower color. It has white flowers, which are really beautiful. This one is, it's like a darling in the South because everybody grows it. So, I mean, the bark, the flowers, everything about this plant is beautiful. Thank you for joining me today. I hope you get a chance to come and see us here at the Scott Arboretum. We are open every day. There's no charge. So come and see our beautiful crepe myrtles or other collections that we have.